Good evening, everybody. Welcome. I'm going to start a little bit mellow tonight because I want to teach you a song. I think it's a song we all need to get in our heads because it's all based on Yahushua's commandments. And it's called Love One Another. You out of slavery, have no mighty ones against my faith. Do not make yourself any carved images, do not bow to them or serve them. No, I am a jealous hell visiting the crookedness. All the generations hating me, but showing kindness to thousands who love me. To everyone who's guarding my command, love one another as I have loved you. Keep my commandments in all that you do. You are my taught ones, if you will bear much fruit. Love's a behavior, I am Yahusha. So love one another as I have loved you. I am Yahuwah, don't cast my name to ruin, for I will punish everyone who does. Remember Shabbat to keep it set apart now. Don't leave your gates, stay at home and rest. For in 6 days I created all things. Then I set the Shabbat day apart for rest. To rest as I did is honoring creation. Shabbat is the covenantal sign. So love one another as I have loved you. Keep my commandments in all that you do. You are my taught ones, if you will bear much. Love's a behavior, I am Yahusha, so love one another as I have loved you. Honor your father and honor your mother, so your days on this earth shall be prolonged. Do not murder. Don't show anyone hatred. Let no root of bitterness inside your heart. Don't break wedlock, don't flirt or have adultery. Do not look at any nakedness. Marriage is sacred, a union between man and wife. And what I bring together, no one splits apart. To love one another as I have loved you. Keep my commandments in all that you do. You are my taught ones, if you will bear much fruit. Love's a behavior. I am Yahusha, so love one another as I have loved you. Don't be stealing or lying. bear a witness that it is false. Just be satisfied with joy and with gladness. And don't be coveting your neighbor's stuff. Let's do that bit again. Don't be stealing or lying. Don't bear witness. Don't bear witness that is false. Just be satisfied with joy and with gladness. And don't be coveting your neighbor's stuff. To love one another as I have loved you. Keep my commandments in all that you do. You are my taught ones, if you will bear my true, yes. Love's a behavior, I am Yahusha. To love one another as I have loved. Love one another. Love one another as I have loved you. Keep my commandments in all that you do. You are my taught ones, if you will bear much fruit. Love's a behavior, I am Yahusha. To love one another as I have loved you. Love one another as I have loved you. Love one another as I have loved you. Yahusha, we welcome you tonight to our fellowship. We ask to do something very special among us. You know where everybody is at. You know what needs encouraging. You know what needs strengthening. You know what needs chastising and burning. We ask that you walk among us tonight as you promised to, and operate in that amazing supernatural way that you are. Give us eyes to see you and ears to hear you. Let us go through this process with you, Yahusha. We love you so much and we welcome you tonight to our fellowship. We come together because we love you so much. Hallelujah. So be it. All right, that was the mellow part. Now, you like that? We're going to do that the next few weeks because on a personal note, that song was written when I was going through a lot of heartache, and I taught it to myself just so I had something to piss all the demons, to get rid of all the demons, you know, so I could play it over in my head. I just learnt that song, and it was his commandments. And then I started singing them to you boys when you wanted to go to sleep. So I think it's time we bring them in. So it's a foundation of what we believe as well, his word. We're going to enter his gates. Come with your mates. Here we go. Enter his gates, come with your mates. Enter his gates with thanks. Come into his courts with happy thoughts. Enter his courts with praise. Let's sing. Enter his gates. Enter his gates, come with your mates. Enter his gates with thanks. Come into his courts with happy thoughts. Enter his courts with praise, because this is the day. This is the day that Yahuwah has made. Yes, this is the day. Let's sing and rejoice.
Sing and rejoice. Gladly lift up his name.
Let's sing, gracious is he.
Gracious is he. Blessed here are we. Soon we will see our King.
Yes, we will.
So come now, rejoice. Lift up your voice. Open your heart and sing.
Let's sing, gracious.
Gracious is he. Blessed here are we. Yes, soon we will see our King.
So come
now, rejoice. Lift up your voice. Open your heart and sing.
This is the day.
This is the day that Yahuwah has made.
Hallelujah. Sing and rejoice.
Sing and rejoice. Lift up his name.
Yes, lift up his name.
He is good, he is good, he is good. Yahusha is good.
Yes.
Great is his loving kindness forever. Yahusha is good.
He is good.
He is good, he is good, he is good. Yahusha is good. Great is his loving kindness forever. Yahusha is good.
Hallelujah.
He is good, he is good, he is.
Yes. Yahusha is so good.
Great is his loving kindness forever. Yahusha is good. He is good, he is good, he is good. Yahusha is good.
Think about how good he is.
His loving kindness forever. Yahusha is good.
He is so good.
He is good, he is good, he is good. Yahusha is good. You are so good. Great is his loving kindness forever. Yahusha is good. He is good, he is good, he is good. Yahusha is good.
Hallelujah.
Great is his loving kindness forever. Yahusha is good. He is good.
Hallelujah. Now we're going to sing the ancient part. All my people,
all my people, you've forgotten me. Burning incense in idolatry.
Stand in the way.
Stand in the way and see. In peace and life you'll be.
Turn my people,
turn my people from your wicked way.
This is how he feels.
You have stumbled into deep decay.
So repent.
Repent and turn your heart,
yes.
A fresh, brand new, clean start. Return to the ancient past.
Yes.
Return to me. Return to the ancient past. Return to me. Return to the ancient past. Return. Return to the ancient path. Return.
will. Prophets and lords, I came to fulfill. I brought no new feeling, I came to bring relief. So come into this romance, bring your life in to this lover's dance. I love you all so much, I know you want my touch. Return to the ancient path, return to me, return to the ancient path, return to me, as he says, return to the ancient path, return to me, no, return to the ancient path, return to me, return to the ancient path, return to me. Return to the ancient path. Return to me.
About the chosen ones. This is how Yahushua feels about us. Sing, I've chosen you. I've chosen you. To speak my truth, to love me above all. Praising, praising my name, my blessings you'll gain. My joy will be in my chosen ones, in my chosen one. My chosen one, my chosen one. My joy will be in my chosen ones, my chosen ones, my chosen ones. My joy will be in my chosen. From darkness I have set you free, so spread my word to all. With a new heart and eternal seed, stand firm and live in my chosen one, in my chosen one. Here we go. My chosen one, my chosen one, my joy will be in my chosen, my chosen one. My chosen one, my joy will be in my chosen one. My word's a sword, the truth in you. My good news must be spread. My royal priests are set apart for me and thee. In my chosen one, in my chosen one. Here we go. My chosen one, my chosen one. My joy will be in my chosen ones, my chosen one. Oh, my chosen one, my joy will be
chosen one, my chosen one, oh my chosen one. My joy will be in my chosen, my chosen one, my chosen one. My joy will be in my chosen one, my chosen one, oh my chosen one. My joy will be in my chosen one, in my chosen one. I believe only Yahusha, my King. Let's sing to Yahusha. He's gathering, yes, gathering us together, us to Him. When two or more gather in His name, yes, to love one another and speak His name, a sweet fragrance ascends and we enter in. It's our daily offering. I receive of His Torah in my heart. Yes, we do. My wedding vows, the commandments I maintain. We honor our marriage to our Yahusha when we obey and serve Him. Where we are, a sweet fragrance ascends to His mighty throne, and His love becomes our own.
I believe
only Yahusha, my King.
He's gathering us together.
Gathering us together, us to Him. When two or more gather in His name, to love one another and speak His name, a sweet fragrance ascends and we enter in. It's our daily offering. It's our daily offering. Yes, it is. It's our daily offering. I believe.
Continue to focus on Yahusha, how wonderful He is.
We have been crafted in, delivered unto Him. We are wild olive trees, we're grafted in. We do not bear the root,
rupees us. Branches were broken off that I be grafted in. A deliverer shall come out of Zion.
Yes, he did.
By covenant, he'll take away our sin. But who has known the mind of Yahusha, Messiah, for the dead of riches, wisdom, and esteem. We are all to blame, where pride goes ashamed. We are returning to our Father's house. Yahusha, run to us with open arms. A banquet being thrown, 'cause we are grafted in.
A deliverer.
A deliverer shall come out of Zion. By covenant you take away our sin. But who has known the mind of Yahusha, Messiah, for the dead of riches, wisdom, and esteem?
A deliverer.
A deliverer shall come out of Zion. By covenant, he'll take away our sin. God who has known the mind of Yahusha, Messiah, for the dead of riches, wisdom, and esteem. Abide in me, and I in you.
This is what Yahusha wants from us.
If you will stay in me, you bear much fruit. Because without me, you can do no good.
That's right.
Abide in me, and I am the vine, you are the branches. If you will bear much fruit, my joy will be in you. If you got my commands, stay in my likewise. You didn't choose me, but I chose you. I have appointed you to bear much fruit. They persecuted me, they'll hate you too. So stay in me, and I in you.
I'm the vine.
I am the vine, you are the branches. If you will bear much fruit, my joy will be in you. If you got my commands, stay my love. You are my taught ones, behave like one.
I'm the vine.
I am the vine. my commands, stay in my love. You are my torpid one, behave likewise. You are my torpid one, behave likewise. You are my torpid one, behave like
mine. Let the behavior come forth. Proof and the fruit of being in Yahushua is letting the fruit come forth, the behavior. To throw your old self on the altar. To offer up new songs, new way of living, new behavior to Yahushua. Getting rid of the old personality, throwing that off, putting that on the stake. Getting rid of that. Coming forth with the new. Yahushua wants us to come forth with the new. Everything he does is fresh. It's amazing. It's mind-blowing. It's completely and astonishingly original. That's what his new is all about. He wants us to come into that new. Put off all the old. Where you've been, what you've done, what you're going through. Run through it. Come to me into the new. Into this love. Into this glow of my joy and my love. Come into my new experience, he says. What you can sing. Deep calls unto deep. Call out to
Yahushua.
I bow my knee.
I bow my knee before your throne. I know my life is not my own.
Face that, guys. Our life is not our own.
This song of praise to bring you pleasure.
Seek Yahushua.
I seek the giver, not the gift. My heart's desire is to lift you high above all earthly things, to bring you pleasure. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. I love you, Yahusha.
Sing to him, hallelujah.
Hallelujah, hallelujah,
for everything you are, I sing.
Hallelujah, I love you, Yahusha. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, 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 I love you, Yahusha, yes, I love you, Yahusha, hallelujah. Hallelujah, 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 I love you, Yahusha, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, I love you, Yahusha. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Sing hallelujah. Hallelujah, I love you, Yahusha. I love you, Yahusha. Always love you. I love you, Yahusha. Hallelujah.
those I have called. You know I have chosen you, for you can feel me. You know in your heart that the path you are on is a righteous one. Follow me, pick up your stake, and believe with all your heart that I will set you free.
Next week, and show us what to do, and guide us as we walk our path, and just keep being there for us and helping us when we need you. And we just love you so much. So be it.
Tonight's pretty exciting. We're progressing with the story of Daniel. Daniel's not actually in it tonight. We're doing chapter 3. This one's about his three mates, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. So, get rid of these things, Danny. Into the furnace. Going to be talking a lot about the fire tonight. All different levels. Abstract, practical, realistically, everything. All about the fire and the furnace. I'll just spend a short moment. Because this has to do with, remember last week, the statue? Nebuchadnezzar had a dream. And who was the only one who could interpret the dream? Daniel was the only one who could interpret the dream through Yahuwah, of course. So, as we know, this statue is going to come up, not this chapter, but a different statue comes up in this chapter, and some believe it's because Nebuchadnezzar had this dream. This was still fresh on his mind. Anyway, let's get on with it. We're going to see this statue explained in many different ways as the chapters go on. Let's get into tonight's study. I want to tell you this up front because I didn't even know this. A lot of people out there, believers, teachers, in Yahusha, out of Yahusha, they think the book of Daniel's a joke. Out of the 66 books, they think that book is just fairy tale. They still teach it and preach it, but they think it's a fairy tale. They don't believe it. A huge population of believers and teachers hold the book of Daniel up as complete fiction and symbolic stories that could never have been historically truth. Why? That shocked me. Why? Because they can't grasp the supernatural reality of how Yahusha operates with his people. The supernatural reality of how Yahusha operates with his people. Which is a shock because he's operating supernaturally from beginning to end of the scriptures. So why is Daniel? It's weird. His hand on them. Many of the passages in the book of Daniel concern prophecy, but also great wisdom. Therefore, it is designed not to simply tell us about the future, but to teach us how to live amidst of a pagan, hostile environment. Keep that in your minds as we go on tonight. This chapter is showing us how to live in the midst of a pagan, hostile environment. We are surrounded by idolatrous Maseroth system. Sun, moon, and star worship. And there are policies in place all around us that are somewhat against Yahusha's word. And we have to deal with daily issues in a very practical way. Yahusha wants us to honor him through our behavior. Got that? As we go into this chapter, Daniel chapter 3. So there's been a bit of a space between the time Nebuchadnezzar's had his vision. Daniel's interpreted it because he's gone a bit nutty here. King Nebuchadnezzar had an image. In Hebrew, that's a statue or an image of gold made that was around 30 meters high and 3 meters wide on the plain of Dura in the province of Babylon. Then he called the governors, advisors, leaders, treasurers, judges, rulers, and all the other officials in his kingdom to come together. In the English loses the power of it here, but it's actually 60 cubits high in Hebrew by 6 cubits wide. And of course, the number 6 is mankind. This is mankind again doing something like the Tower of Babel. Look at us. We can rule ourselves. Come down and worship us, that sort of thing. So that's a little note there to myself. 60 times 6 cubits is the number of man. So it's symbolic in the Hebrew language. So he's built this statue. He wanted all of them to come to the dedication ceremony for this massive statue. So all the men came and stood in front of the image that Nebuchadnezzar had set up. Then the herald who makes announcements for the king spoke in a loud voice. All you people from many nations and languages, listen to me. This is what you're commanded to do. You must bow down. Bow down as soon as you hear the sound of all the musical instruments. When you hear the horns, the flutes, the lyres, the sambucas, the harps, the bagpipes, and all the other musical instruments, you must worship the gold image. Most believe that a sambuca is an ancient harp with about 7 strings on it. So when you hear all those things, you must worship the gold image. This reminds us of like a national anthem, doesn't it? You've got to stand there, whatever you can do, whatever country you're in. Got to do something when the national anthem plays. This is what this was like. When the music plays, you come and bow down to this image. The king has set this image up. So whoever does not bow down and worship this gold image will be thrown into a very hot furnace immediately. Interestingly, Moses compared Israel's Egyptian slavery to an iron furnace. So there's all sorts of imagery flying around in this chapter. What does this also remind us of? Bowing down to the image. We just finished Revelation. This is also a shadow of Revelation, where John says that in the last days, all people, both rich and poor, slave and free, will be forced to bow down and worship the image of the beast, an accepted and known behavior of brazen idolatry. Brazen meaning right out there in your face. Happy, proud, I'm disobedient, I'm wicked, and I'm going to celebrate it. Brazen idolatry against Yahushua. So today it's not just a statue. People do bow to statues, but today it's a full-on behavior of obsession and idolatry. So as we go on to notice that it says it's an image. In the Hebrew it says he's built an image. It doesn't say what of. That's where we have to guess what it's of. And we'll get into that in a moment. It just says a statue. That could be anything. I mean, obviously all the cartoons are showing an image of a man. But let's go on. So as soon as they heard the sound of the horns, the flutes, the lyres, the sambucas, bagpipes, and all the other musical instruments, all the peoples from different nations and languages bowed down and worshipped the gold image. Daniel clearly wants us to see a close connection. Daniel's writing this. He wants us to see a close connection between the king's dream and the statue which he erected here. Was this an innocent response to the meaning of his empire's dream? Was the king just coming fresh off his statue dream and I'm the head of gold, I'm Babylon, I'm all powerful, I'm going to honor Yahuwah by building a statue of myself? Is that what you think he's doing? Not likely. Not in this culture. Remember, this is Babylon. Who started Babylon? It's pretty obvious that his motivation was from Nimrod. and Neo-Babylonia, for he wasn't ignorant of Nimrod's attempt to build a tower to the heaven. And King Nebuchadnezzar was now walking in the footsteps of Nimrod by setting up his own authority, drawing his own blueprints for a worldwide kingdom that should never crumble and fall. Why shouldn't I? I'm the head of gold. This was his insanely egotistical reaction to Daniel's meaning of his dream. You understand that? He was so puffed up and lifted up by what Daniel said that dream meant. I'm the head of gold. Your kingdom, that sort of thing. I'm going to make this a reality. So he took it. He didn't just build the head of gold, did he? He made the whole statue of gold. The statue may have been a likeness of the king or a Babylonian deity, or maybe it was an astronomical body or just a geometric shape. It's not actually written in the text what the shape of the statue is. We can guess. Historians have looked at it. Many believe, and like this is very similar to what we've been seeing in the cartoons, many believe that it was this idol here. This is one of the two Nebo statues found in the Nebo temple at Calais. It is assumed that the king made the statue of himself. However, Nebo was the national deity of Babylon. So this is what it probably looked like. Because remember how superstitious they were. They've got to honor some kind of deity. And this was their chief deity in Babylon. This is an ancient quote there. Trust in the god Nebo. Do not trust in another god. And if you look here, the meanings of the names, we're not going to go through them all. Meanings of the names of the Babylonian kings. If you go down to anywhere you see Nebu is Nebo. Nebuchadnezzar, Nebu. O Nebu, defend the landmark. Even more interesting down here, Daniel's name was changed to Belshazzar. Bel, which is Baal. Marduk, guard his life. So that would not have impressed Daniel too much, would it? Being named after a pagan deity. But doesn't say that he objected to that. He only objected to eating the king's food. So critics say that the mention of this statue is just more evidence that Daniel is pure fantasy. Because not only is the statue so illogically huge, its proportions are all wrong, being an unworkable 10 to 1 ratio. You can't build something that's 10 to 1 ratio, that tall and that thin, it'll fall over. Perhaps they need to travel to Washington, D.C. and visit the Washington Monument. It is 170 meters high and 17 meters wide at its base, a 10 to 1 ratio. So once again, critics can go get stuffed. You know, this is a true story. It's inspired by Yahuwah. He did build this statue and the account is true. And this is what most people think it looked like. Refusing to bow down is treason. And the penalty is death. But the reality is that it wouldn't have even bothered most of the many nations and peoples who formed Babylon. For they were not being asked to give up or replace their gods, but just to bow down to yet another one as a subject of Babylon. So no problem for the Babylonians. They've got lots of deities, a whole pantheon. But for the Jews, it was a grave matter. For they were commanded to acknowledge only the one true living Elohim, Yahuwah. So do you think there would have been some sneaky play? Do you think the Babylonians would have known that behind the scenes? These Jews are only allowed to worship one. Let's see how they cop this. Let's see how they handle this. Check out this power play. Then some of the Chaldeans, these are the guys at the university, the intellectuals, Chaldeans came up to the king, began speaking against the people from Judah, saying, King, may you live forever. Great king, you gave a command saying that everyone who hears the sound of the music must bow down and worship the gold image. And you also said that whoever doesn't bow down and worship the image will be thrown into a very hot furnace. Well, there are some Judeans, some Jews, who you made important, who you, made important officials in the province of Babylon that ignored your order, O king. Their names are Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. They don't worship your gods and goddesses, and they refuse to bow down and worship the gold image you set up. So Nebuchadnezzar became furious and called for Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego to come to him. Let's look at the power play briefly. The issue is very transparent. These sniveling Chaldean snitches, native Babylonians, didn't like a bunch of outsider Jews having the high government positions that rightfully belonged to them. Remember, the king had given these high-ranking positions to these three Jewish men as a result of Daniel being able to interpret his dream. Not only had the Jews humiliated these Chaldeans by being able to know the king's dream when they couldn't, but they were now their bosses. They now had a higher rank than the Chaldeans did. They'd been raised up, the last chapter says, after Daniel's interpretation. Nebuchadnezzar well knew, as did everyone in Babylon, especially in the capital city, well knew that the Jews had one Elohim only, and they weren't permitted to worship other deities. So this incident was just the opportunity the Chaldeans needed to end their shame by getting rid of these three Jewish officials. Understand this? It's a power play going on. So Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were brought to King Nebuchadnezzar, who said to them, "Gentlemen, is it true that you don't worship my deities and that you didn't bow down and worship the gold image I've set up? Now when you hear the sound of the horns, flutes, lyres, sambucas, harps, bagpipes, and all the other musical instruments, you will bow down and worship my gold idol, damn it. If you're ready to worship the image I've made, good. If you don't worship it, you will be taken immediately and thrown into the burning hot furnace. Then no deity will be able to deliver you from my hand then." He's off his face. This is all about political correctness. The king has put them in charge of the government of his own capital city, these Jews. And to be rebels in this manner makes the king look very bad. Can't they just play the game? What harm would it do? Just go along with it and everyone will live, prosper and be happy. Isn't that how people see it today? Just, what have we got to cause trouble for? Just get on with it. Just, you know, I've made you these chief, given you high status, and now you're causing trouble for me. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered the king, "Nebuchadnezzar, we don't need to explain these things to you." How about saying that to the king? "We don't need to explain these things to you. We don't have to explain ourselves to you. If you throw us into the hot furnace, the Elohim we serve can deliver us. If he wants to, he can deliver us from your hand. If he wants to. He can deliver us from your hand. But even if Yahuwah doesn't, cop this bit, even if Yahuwah doesn't deliver us, we want you to know, O king, that we flat out refuse to serve your deities. So no, we will not bow down and worship the ridiculous gold image that you've set up. Even if Yahuwah doesn't deliver us, we will not bow down." Strength in these guys, isn't there? Character. If you say no, do you want to turn the aircon down, mate? You're right. If you say no to the beast's behavior, you're in for fire. Got that? Bring it forward 3,000 years or so. If you say no to the beast's behavior, you're in for fire. And not the fire you might expect. I'm not talking about worldly fire or punishment there. These men understand that Yahuwah has chosen. Remember last chapter we decided that Nebuchadnezzar was not an evil king. He was set up there by Yahusha. to take over and punish Israel. These men understood that Yahuwah had chosen Nebuchadnezzar to be his servant on earth at this time and has given him dominion over every sphere, sea, land, and air. So in essence, they are saying, we really don't have a choice in the matter. What you have been told is true, and there's not much we could say to change your mind. But then comes the heart-searing part where they say that whether Yahuwah does or doesn't rescue them from a horrible, painful death, nonetheless, they will not serve Babylon's deities and they will not lay prostrate, which is to lay down flat. Prostrate yourself is to lay down flat before the statue. They will not. The statue is the symbol of the one world power that is the Babylonian Empire. That's what this statue represented. It wasn't just, so there was no no church and state back. There was no religion and worldliness. It was all together, all wrapped up together. So it was not only a religious symbol, it was a political head of gold. This is the most powerful kingdom in the world. Many believe Nebuchadnezzar had traveled to Egypt and seen what they did with all their obelisks and statues. I can be better than that, he says. This is what Solomon said, though, and we saw what happened to Solomon towards the end of his life, and this is how he summarized everything before he died. In Ecclesiastes 12, here is the final conclusion. Now that you've heard everything, fear Yahuwah and keep his commandments. For this is what being human is all about. Interesting statement. This is what being human is all about. For Yahuwah will bring to judgment everything we do, including every secret, whether good or bad. In case I forget, do you look at life like that? Do you look at behavior like that? Do you look and see that every single secret thing that you think will stay hidden will be brought out into the light? Yahuwah does it. It's not a matter of mum and dad or friends and family. And Yahuwah does it. He brings everything out into the open. What's in the darkness, he'll bring into the light, whether good or bad. Since Solomon was addressing Hebrews in that scripture, what he really meant was what being a redeemed. That's what being a redeemed human is all about. Because obviously out in the world, that's not what being a human is about out there, is it? But to us, the whole reason, the whole what's the meaning of life, why am I put here, is to love Yahuwah, fear Yahuwah, keep his commandments. That's what being human is all about. That's the only purpose we're on this earth. It's the only purpose Yahuwah made Adam and Eve. Love me, keep my command. They only had one. We've got 10 main ones. And that's what being human is all about. And the second commandment is to only worship Yahuwah, Elohim, and no other. Remember it says, do not bow down to idols. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were willing to die to uphold this fundamental commandment. Is that fanaticism? A bit over the top? No. It is an example of the loyalty that is expected of Yahusha's bridal fellowship. To say no, a lot of it, most of it for us is behavior and what comes to in our heads. Then Nebuchadnezzar's expression. Remember they've just told him pretty much to go shove it. We're not going to bow down to your image. It's ridiculous. So then Nebuchadnezzar's expression, or in Hebrew it says image, just like the image he built up. His image changed. The expression on his face changed. He saw red and was filled with rage against Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, filled with rage. He gave an order for the furnace to be heated 7 times hotter than it usually was. Then he commanded some of his strongest warriors in the army to tie up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and throw them into the raging hot furnace. So Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were bound and thrown into the hot furnace. They were wearing their robes, pants, turbans, and other clothes. Normally you would strip people if you're going to throw them into a fire, but this was extra flameage. Let them burn. That'll catch on fire quicker. Let's have a light show. They were very happy to see this. The king was furious. You defy me, you're going straight in. Crank it up hot now. The king was so angry. When he gave the command, that soldiers quickly pumped the furnace so hot that the flames even killed the mighty warriors when they approached the fire to throw the three men in. I mean, you've all been around a bonfire, haven't you? You know how just standing, you know, you can walk as close as you can and it just becomes unbearable. Well, these guys had to actually go to the edge to throw them in. I'll show you a picture shortly of what it might have looked like, the kiln that they were thrown into. The soldiers had to get so close that they died. This poor guy, he's burnt to a crisp just to throw them in. So Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego fell into the fire, bound up very tightly. Interestingly, they were tested right to the point of entry. Yahuwah tested them, didn't he? They've said this to the king. They're bold there. But are they still feeling bold when they're walking up to the fire? Clearly, he tested them and they passed it. See this picture here of an ancient kiln? This is an ancient kiln there. They're obviously thrown in through the top, but people could see through the hole in the side here. They needed holes in the side for the air to get into, the fire would rage. So they could see in there. A lime kiln, that's what it is, an ancient lime kiln. So as King Nebuchadnezzar watched this with great satisfaction, he suddenly jumped to his feet, freaked out of his mind. He was stunned at what he saw and asked his advisors, "What's he seeing? What's he seeing?" He asked his advisors, "Didn't we only tie up three men and throw them into the fire?" His advisors said, "We certainly did, O king." "Well, look, I can see four men walking around in the fire. They're not tied up. They're not even burning. And the fourth man looks like the son of a deity." Some versions say son of an angel. Some say son of GD. It's in this king with a lot of pantheon of deities. It was some supernatural figure. The fourth one looks like an angel, a supernatural figure. Who would that be? Alternate translations include eyewitness accounts that state that the king heard the men singing and praising Yahuwah in the fire. That would have enraged him even more. So who was this supernatural being? I believe it was Yahusha in the fire with them. The preservation, this is why I think that, the preservation of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego within the furnace is a literal fulfillment of a promise given by Isaiah. Shadow, and it's a shadow directly for us here today. Because in Isaiah he says, "People of Jacob, Yahuwah who created you and formed you, O Yisrael, says this, fear not," take this guys to yourselves, "fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by your name, and you are mine. When you walk through the waters, I'll be there with you. And through the rivers, they won't drown you. When you walk through the fire, you won't be burnt, and the flame won't scorch you. For I am Yahuwah, your Elohim, the set-apart one of Yisrael, your deliverer." And Yahuwah also says in Malachi 3:6, "I am Yahuwah, and I do not change. That is why you are not consumed, O sons of Jacob," Yisrael, the bride. He's saying to us, "I do not change. That's why you're not all destroyed, burnt up, frackled up. We should be." So can you see how this is a promise? And these guys believed it. And Yahusha was with them in the fire. Remember when John sees a sea of glass like crystal in the heavenly temple? Let's shoot to the end of time now. Later he sees it again, but this time it's mingled with fire. "For on it stands all the martyrs, those who have had to lose their physical lives for being a witness of Yahusha through the ages. And like them, even if Yahusha chooses not to deliver us in our flesh, even if we are faced with physical death, even if Yahusha chooses not to deliver us, still we will not bow down to this global beastly system of idolatry." No. Do you feel like that? It's up to him what happens to our physical lives. even if we should not bow down. Despite last day pressure, Yahushua has us in his hand always. So Nebuchadnezzar's freaked out. Then Nebuchadnezzar went to the opening of the hot furnace and shouted, Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, come out now, servants of the Most High Elohim, come here. So the men came out of the fire. And satraps, prefects, governors, and royal advisors crowded around them. They could see that the fire had not burnt Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Their bodies were not burnt at all. Their hair was not burnt, and their robes were not burnt. They didn't even smell as if they had been near a fire. Then Nebuchadnezzar said, praise the Elohim of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Their Elohim has sent his angel and delivered his servants from the fire. These three men trusted their Elohim and refused to obey my command. They were willing to give up their bodies and die. They were willing to give up their bodies, their flesh, and die instead of serving or worshipping any other deity. So I now make this law. Anyone from any nation or language who says anything against the Elohim of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego will be cut into pieces, and their house will be destroyed until it's a pile of dirt and ashes. No other deity can deliver his people like this Elohim can. Now, was he swearing allegiance to this Elohim? Or was he just adding him into his portfolio, into his pantheon? Then the king promoted Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego into higher positions in the province of Babylon. The Gentile Nebuchadnezzar professes belief in the Elohim of Israel, but does not acknowledge the fullness of just who that being is, nor his exclusivity. Nebuchadnezzar believed that Yahuwah existed and is a great Elohim, but relates to him only in the worldview of paganism and secular humanism. What does that mean? As I said, he's just added them to his pantheon of deities. One of many. This is a religious experience for Nebuchadnezzar, not a relationship. In James 2, it says, You believe that Yahuwah is one? Good for you, big whoop. The demons believe it too and shudder with fear at the thought. Demons believe that Yahuwah is one. They know Yahuwah. But foolish one, don't you know that such belief without active behavior is useless? Demons believe, but are they actively behaving as Yahushua wants them to? Not at all. Neither Nebuchadnezzar nor many immersed believers have a true understanding of who Yahushua is. And they don't let him have their whole life or acknowledge his supernatural in their day. Why wouldn't they do that? Even if they know about it, why wouldn't they do it? They want their own way. Because Yahushua is a consuming fire, he says. Back up further there. Yahushua is a consuming fire, and coming close to him is very hot. If you're going to come close to Yahushua, it's hot. And I want to finish tonight on these few scriptures about the furnace of affliction. If we look up the word furnace, it says a hot fire. So we all know what a furnace is, no mystery there. If we look at the scriptures, though, refining furnace in Isaiah 48, behold, I have refined you, but not as silver. I have tested you in the furnace of affliction. What's he going to do? Test us in the furnace of affliction. So if you refuse to bow down to the world and its behavior and its ways, and you choose to come close to Yahushua, then the heat starts getting turned up even more because he's going to test you, as he should. In Zechariah 13, it says, I bring the one-third through the fire. I will bring the one-third through the fire. We'll refine them as silver is refined and test them as gold is tested. Gold is tested in the hottest fire. This here is gold being purified. Proverbs 17, the refining pot is for silver and the furnace for gold. But I, Yahuwah, I test the hearts. Understand that? I test the hearts. What we let come into our heart, what's in our heart comes out, what we choose to behave, that whole process, I'm testing it, he says. So this is like a shadow, isn't it? The silver and the gold and the fire and the furnace is a shadow for what's going on inside your body. You're being tested daily. If we go to the newer scriptures, it says in 1 Peter, the purpose of these troubles is to test you. Trials, pressures. The purpose of these troubles is to test you as fire tests how genuine gold is. You heat up gold, and if nothing comes to the top, it's perfect. If all this sludge and dross and dirty stuff comes to the top, Yahushua has to scrape it off, if we allow him to. He's testing us like gold is tested. So Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were tested, weren't they? They're declaring they weren't going to eat the wrong foods like Daniel wasn't. They were having supernatural gifts like Daniel was having. But then they were put to the test. They wanted to go further, so he tested them. Doesn't mention any other Jews that stood up and refused to bow down, did it? So clearly a lot of the other Jews bowed down. They all had the same commandments. What are we tested on in our day? What is he testing us for? He's testing us to see if we will obey these things here. These things here are our eternal marriage covenant vows. And this is the only moral and legal standard of right and wrong. No matter what's being said out there, you want to know what right and wrong is? There are 10 written in stone, actually, right and wrong here. He says, I am Yahuwah your Elohim, who brought you out of Egypt, out of your slavery. I'm your only mighty one. You will have no other but me. Don't dare raise up. Don't dare love something else in my face. I'm the one who brought you out of slavery, he says. You will have only me. I'm the only living Elohim. Two, he says, do not bow to idols. Only serve me. All the pagan festivals. We know what idolatry is now. We've been through it a few times. Money, sex, drugs, oh, you name it. Wealth, everything that's going on in the world. Obsessions. Loving anything above Yahushua is idolatry. Do not cast my name to ruin. Always use the name Yahuwah and Yahushua. Do not cast the name of Yahuwah your Elohim to ruin. The world doesn't even know or want his name, do they? Don't want it. Number four, rest on the Shabbat day. Guard the seventh day. Guard the seventh day as set apart. Honor your father and your mother. Even if you don't agree, particularly as you become adults, even if you don't agree with everything they do, you must respect them as people because they gave birth to you. Yeah? That doesn't mean you have to bow down and come under them and all that stuff. It means inside yourself, all the judgments and all the things that you might have, you got to get rid of it and you got to honor. That's what honoring is. Honor your father and mother. And you will live long in the land, he says. Number six, do not murder. Yahushua came along and said, don't show hatred to your brother either. Don't call him an idiot. Don't say horrible things to him. Do not murder or show hatred. Number seven, do not break up a marriage. Don't break up your own. Don't break up anybody else's either. Don't come between something that Yahushua has brought together. Don't break up a marriage. Don't break wedlock. Yahushua came along and said, that's great, but I'm telling you, don't even look lustfully at someone else. Don't look lustfully at any nakedness. Don't do it. This is the difference between right and wrong according to Yahushua. And that's all that matters, isn't it? 8, do not steal or kidnap. Straightforward. It's not yours. Don't take it. 9, do not lie or speak maliciously. Don't speak false. Don't spread false witness. Give false, give a false opinion or an account, a reputation of somebody else. Speaking maliciously, spreading gossip, things like that. Do not covet, desiring other people's stuff. Don't want, that's not talking about looking at something and go, oh, that'd be nice. Oh, look, that's nice. Oh, cool. That's desiring it. I'm going to have it. I'm going to have it. I'm coveting it. I really want it. I'm desiring it. Because we see things all around us that are nice. It's not talking about that. It's talking about desiring it with a deep desire. Covet. Yahusha came along and made a summary. He said, Yahusha's bridal summary, he says, love one another as I have loved you. That's how he summarized these 10 words. Love one another as I have loved you. How far did he go with his love for us? Died for us, gave himself up, made himself a servant and nothing. We're very fortunate in the behavior evolution that Yahusha gave us some rules to summarize these, because going out into your day, I have to love one another. I have to love one another. I have to love one another. What does that mean? Things are coming at you all the time. These rules. Don't take anything personal. Let everyone have it and don't make excuses. You can put them, as you know, to every single situation in your life. These are a summary of this, and this is a summary of this. So we're bringing all this right down into very practical in every thought. Check your thoughts. Don't take anything anybody says personal. Don't. Let everyone have it. Let them have it. Am I letting everyone have it? Am I making excuses? Am I lying? Am I trying to make myself feel better? So we're going to be tested on this, guys. By fire, tested by fire. So, Yahusha wants a response from us. He wants a heartfelt response. Because if you've been doing any of these things that are wrong, are you going to be right or wrong? So I'd like you all to close your eyes and review yourself. This is the definition of right and wrong. Now, I raised a lot of you in these, even though I didn't really know Yahusha myself back then, raised you in these. But as you become older, you take liberties. You think you can get away with things, don't you? If you do, you're going to have lots of consequences. And Yahusha wants you to clean them all out. So tonight, I ask and I pray that you would face all these things. Anybody who's done any of these things, broken any of these commandments, loved something more than Yahusha, spent more time with something than Yahusha, lifted something up as an idol above Yahusha, not wanted to use his name, not wanting to rest in the Shabbat, doing other things, not wanting to respect or obey your father and mother, showing hatred to someone, looking lustfully at something, stealing, lying, coveting, deeply desiring other people's stuff. If those sins have been in you, cleanse yourself out. Cleanse yourself out. If you've been into any of those things this week, I'd like you to put your hand up. If you've felt any of those things. This is between you and Yahusha. Altar is open, brother and sisters. Ask Yahusha to forgive you. Be cleansed. by his amazing love.
Yahushua is here.
Remember, Yahushua is going to put us through the fire. If we declare we believe in him, if we declare we want to come closer to him, it might seem unfair. Doesn't he have the right to test us? Doesn't he have the right to purify us so that we can be perfected and be like him? He wants a genuine bride. He wants a genuine bride. We need to become that. So if you're going to come close to him, it's hot. Are you willing to endure that fire? Do you take it personally when he touches you, shows you, gives you consequences? Because if you do, you're not willing to go through the fire.
You need to be. Good to see
you remember all the commandments and then you're all doing them perfectly. Beautiful. You can all stand up now, please. Keep on setting us apart, Yahusha, your crown with many crowns. Resound, resound, resound through your supernatural, Yahusha, we prep our wedding. Surround with your healing power of love. We all pray our loved ones will be found.
Your crown
through the portal on our hearts. Yahusha, your crown with many crowns. Yahushua, we thank you for meeting with us tonight. Thank you for showing us what being close to you is going to entail so that we know to be looking for you in every situation in our lives. Your supernatural should be prevalent in everything, in the forefront of our hearts, of our minds. Make us aware of this, Yahushua, more and more. We pray for our loved ones up the hill and down south. We pray that you continue to move We know that you have them all safely in your hand. Draw us closer this week, Yahusha. Bring up the issues you want to bring up. Burn the things you want. Heat us up. We're all committed to you. We've said it with our mouths that we commit ourselves to you. So now we know that that entails burning hot fire. We love you, Yahusha, so much. So be it.
For better, for worse, for what wins, best of best, catch up on the end. Mixing up a storm, brewing up a tornado.
Having an abundance of platonic relationships, reminiscent of my man, Mike Plato.
I was running down the street, just screaming, I was blind, but I lost my voice, like I lost my mind. And I couldn't get another, couldn't get another, couldn't get another.